What is up? This is the Nook Podcast. My name is Stephen, and I am so honored that you would take some time to listen today. If you have any questions, comments, or critiques on this or any of my episodes, please drop me an email. The address is Stephen@nookpodcast.com. That is always included in the show notes, along with a link for Buy Me a Coffee, which is a safe and simple way for you to financially support this show. And real quick, I'd like to thank the fine folks who have donated. It really does help. Welcome to March, and if you are listening to this sometime in the future, the episodes for this month of March 2022 are all about adoption. And maybe you're thinking, hey, wait a second, isn't November National Adoption Month? Well, yes it is, and you are very astute for knowing that. But here's how I'm framing it. My birthday is this month, and I was adopted as an infant. My family and friends would tell you that I am one of those weirdos who just isn't especially excited about my birthday. So I decided that what I could do is make a big deal about adoption this month. I view my adoption as such an indescribable gift. I believe with 100% conviction that my life wouldn't be anything like it is had I not been adopted. In fact, I have to wonder if it would have been at all. Moving forward to the time when I accepted Christ and started to understand all of what that meant, I remember one of the first times that I read Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5. It says, God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. And it occurred to me that I was adopted twice. So for this month, I would like to come at my birthday from a different approach through the amazing gift of adoption. Once I had decided that this is the way that I would theme this month, I knew that I had to start with my sister, Erin Smalley. We were both adopted, just 2 years apart. And the fact that we were adopted isn't some weird asterisk in our relationship. She is my sister. God grafted us together as siblings, and I am so grateful for that. But the story doesn't end there. 11 years ago, Erin and her husband adopted a little girl from China, and she has been an amazing addition to our family. I love this story, not only because it happened in our family, but also because it has God's fingerprints all over it. So settle in for this adoption story with Erin Smalley. What occurred to me in just thinking about what I wanted to talk to you about, what I wanted to get into with you, is that you and I have just always known what we know. That's just who we've always been. I'm adopted. Yes. You're adopted. We're adopted. I don't know at what point it occurred to me in our childhood when it occurred to me that nobody in our house is related. It's just four people strangely brought together, no blood relation. And we just always knew. And I think about, and maybe it's just because TV has strangely sensationalized stuff like that, where you hear about stories or movies or whatever, where kids don't find out until much later in life, and it can be so damaging and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. We just always knew. And it occurs to me that you and I have never really had great discussions about our adopted lives, because it's just who we were, and there was no discomfort with it. There was
there was no lying, no covering it up. No, it was never a secret. And a matter of fact, it was seen as a gift.
Oh, very much so.
And I don't know if mom would say to you, like, Erin, you know that God brought you all the way from the other side of the state to me.
Well, and she did it similarly, but it was more along the lines of how we were chosen. Mm-hmm. We were so wanted. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't that our birth parents didn't want us, because it's not like she sullied anybody's reputation or.
She always said it was that they couldn't provide a family for us.
Yes.
And so they loved us enough to give us away to a family.
Right.
And yeah, but it's so interesting because I will often say to Annie, my daughter adopted from China.
Whoa, spoiler alert. We were going to get to that later, but go ahead.
Oh, that God brought you all the way from the other side of the world mm-hmm. to me. And I used to think, gosh, when my mom would say, or our mom would say, from the other side of the state, I was like, that's so far. How did God do right. that? And now I'm like, how did God bring me just the perfect one from the other side of the world?
Right.
And to know that I feel the exact same way about her as I do my biological children.
Right. And I think that's really what I want to try to center on this month. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's two, three scriptures that I can't think of chapter and verse right off the top of my head, but where adoption is spoken of in God's yes. word about how God chose to adopt us because it brought him great pleasure. And at the risk of sounding goofy, I've always identifying with that scripture, I almost feel like I had an unfair advantage because I feel like I identify with that maybe better than somebody who wasn't adopted. Mm-hmm. I totally understand what it means to be adopted and am all the more grateful that's the way God thinks of us.
Yes.
Did that kind of thing ever cross your mind?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, because I can't think of the scriptures off the top of my head. But there's so many of them that talk about, you know, you were chosen and you were adopted into his bloodline.
Yes.
And you think about, I didn't really realize this is crazy. I didn't really realize Jesus was adopted.
Yes.
By Joseph.
Yep.
And, you know, it's funny that I never really realized that, but it's a significant thing. And I don't know if you remember growing up, people wouldn't believe that we were adopted. Mm-hmm. And they would argue,
we're
not adopted. But in the same breath, it was such a positive thing.
Yes.
That when people would argue about it, I'd be like, why are you arguing about this?
Right. Yeah. Like I would make this up.
Yeah. Why is this something to argue about? This is just, I always say I knew I was adopted really about the same time I understood that I was a girl. It was just one of those things. And so, you know, but then I think understanding that the gift that we were given, when you think about it in God's economy, you know, it's one of those things that if we choose it, it just is.
Yes.
Well, and we can't explain it.
Right. And how strangely that seems when you put it, I love that you use the term God's economy. When you frame it up like that, it somehow means more than blood. Because I agree with you. It seems like it wasn't so very long ago that whole lineage of Jesus, his family tree, that it's one of those things that, you know, the scholars and historians cannot. It's like, well, this is part of what makes sense. Even if the faith side of it boggles you, if Jesus had not been adopted by Joseph, then that whole family line would have been completely thrown off.
Correct.
That whole son of David thing janks without Joseph in the picture. And that to me was mind blowing. And I thought I had a decent handle on the whole adoption thing for years.
Yeah, it is. It is a fascinating thing. And just such a glorious thing and an orchestrated thing.
Yes.
And I've dug in a lot lately. I'm also a therapist a lot lately around attachment and how God created us to be connected specifically to him and then to each other. And I say he created marriage so that part of that connection, one of the greatest places we're connected and known is in our marriage.
Yes.
And how he uses that connection, that attachment to our spouse to bring, it has the opportunity to bring healing to attachment wounds we bring with us into marriage.
Right.
From our family of origin.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's just fascinating to me that it doesn't surprise me that God allowed this adoption thing mm-hmm. to be part of the lineage of Jesus, because it's such a unique, ordained, purposeful
yes.
thing. You know, I think especially that you're loved equally, like someone adopted, but that's true with God as well. That I was just doing a Bible study yesterday that talked about, doesn't matter if we come to Christ, you know, at 5 years old or at 95 years old, as we're taking our last breath.
Yeah.
We are all adopted in.
Yep. With the same with rights equal. And
yes, we all go to heaven.
That's amazing. So yeah, you're right.
It's deep. Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm curious then, to your, since you kind of beat yeah. me to the punch, you had three children, all of your own,
yes.
all by normal yes. means, nudge, yes. nudge. What was going through the thought process for you and Greg when you decided mm-hmm. to enter into what was an arduous process to bring mm-hmm. sweet Annie to come live with you? How did you even yeah. consider that, let alone decide, yeah. all right, we're going for it?
Yeah, I don't know if you knew this, but before I would say yes to getting engaged, I asked Greg if he would be at least open to adoption someday, because I said, I dreamt about adopting since I was a little girl.
Mm.
And so I knew that I needed to marry someone who was at least open
yeah.
to the thought. And I always say he agreed to it, and I think he would have agreed to anything at that point. So I think I should have asked for more, but he definitely agreed. So
noticeably absent from this conversation right now
yeah.
is one Dr. Greg Smalley.
Yes. we prayed about it and had three bios, and we were teaching at a family camp and teaching couples about, you know, asking God what he was calling them to together. Like as a couple. And for us, because we always knew that adoption was a possibility, we did the same thing. On the break, we went out just like we asked the couples to do and prayed and asked God, you know, what are you calling us to? And it was pretty clear for both of us. We're like, you know what, maybe it's time to start looking at the possibility of adopting. And I don't know if you know this part either. This is funny having this conversation with you, by the way.
Seriously.
My big brother, that I was always fascinated with mom's middle name, Antoinette.
Mm. Yep.
She's Rosalie Antoinette. And so I'd always ask her, how do you spell it, mom? Antoinette.
Yep.
And so that day that Greg and I were out praying, I said, what if we named a little girl Antoinette Rose after mom and called her Annie? And so mom knew before she passed away, that was, if we ever adopted, that was going to be the name.
Mm.
And ironically, mom died in April. Annie was born in July that same year.
Yeah. That I remember.
Yeah. So she, so we named a little girl that day, told our kids about Annie. We prayed for Annie for 7 years. Nothing happened. We ended up going to China with Chick-fil-A to do some work with some couples over there. And we joked, we're like, hey, maybe Annie's here. Maybe she's here. I said, can we go to an orphanage? And they're like, no, you can't. They won't let you in. And I was like, well, great. But we got home and one of our friends had been in China and he went to an American Christian orphanage and they let him in and they handed him a little girl when he walked in.
Wow.
And he held this little girl and he was telling us about how beautiful this little girl was and on. And he said, hey, by the way, our friends, who run the orphanage are Americans and they're Christians and they want to, you know, bring people over to do marriage work. Would you guys be willing? Because that's what we do. And we're like, gosh, yes, we loved going to China. And the crazy thing, we were just in Hawaii last week and a man came up to me and he said, I was at that conference you guys
did.
No
way.
Yeah. Yes. And that was, let's see, 13 years ago.
Wow.
And he's like, I was there. And I was like, no way. In Kunming, China, we were there. Oh my word. So, long story short, that our friend who held the little girl at the American Christian Orphanage connected us with the orphanage directors because, he wanted us them to know that we could come over to do marriage stuff. So sent an email, CC'd us on it, and, you know, said, hey, this is Greg and Erin Smalley, you know, marriage stuff, la, la, la. And then, hey, how's that little girl doing that I held? And they responded back, great to meet you, Greg and Erin. And then they responded back about the little girl and they said, Annie is doing great.
Wow.
And I, when I read the email, I almost fell over. I was like, who's Annie? And then I went, oh my word. Annie is the little girl that our friend held. And so from that moment forward, I was like, well, we've been praying for an Annie for 7 years. So it sure seems to me like we need to do something. And so I started calling agencies and they said, you know, it can't do that with China. China, you know, assigns you a child. You can't choose a child. And I was like, well, what do you want me to do? We've been praying for an Annie. Her name is Annie.
And you found one.
We found one and never dreamt we thought we would rename a little girl Annie.
Right.
But finally, Holt International, they have a big presence in China. And they said, you know what? Give us everything you know. And about her, they found her file and they said, you guys, if you start your process now, we'll start watching for her file because she's not available for adoption yet. And so we started our home study and all our fees and all the paperwork. It's more work than writing a book.
Sure.
To adopt.
Isn't that insane?
It's insane. Yeah. And so we started our process and waited and waited. No Annie, no Annie. Month after month. And, oh, lovely. My dog is barking. And then I got an email at one point, probably 6 months later. And they said, tonight we got Annie's file. She's yours.
Wow. Okay. But how much longer did it take from that point?
It was that point. It went pretty fast. It was a total of 18 months. So maybe that was like 9 months when we got her file. And then it was about 6 months before we could go to get her.
Wow. But and still, you'd been praying for her at
seven plus years. And the crazy thing, so this is how God so worked. And I am telling you, I've never experienced God's presence more tangibly in my life than through that process. Because not only did he bring us an Annie, she had one nanny who we knew she loved the most. It was her mama, because they were in her orphanage. They were very intentional about attachment. So they each child had one main primary attachment as a nanny. And just take one guess what her nanny's name was. We named her Antoinette Rose, Annie Rose. She was Annie, and the nanny's name was Rose. I mean, I literally went, okay, God, I need to go home and get ready. We're having a baby. And, you know, just walking that out in faith. And, you know, we got a lot of critics coming at us. There was a lot of criticism as far as, you have three healthy children. Why would you do this? And that was from well-meaning Christians, people who were concerned because Annie on paper looks like she has a lot of heavy duty special needs. She does have special needs, but you would never know it. She functions beautifully.
Oh, she's a spunky little kid.
Oh, she is. She's about to start running track.
I want to say she's a little kid. She's a teenager now. And
she's 14. Yes. She's been home for 11 years. She came, we all went over to China to get her, all five of us as a family. And the day came, July 4th, 2010. A knock on the door, and or actually the phone rang and they said, we're downstairs, we've got Annie. So they're like, get ready. So we're all standing by the door waiting for that moment. Knock on the door, we open the door. We're like, all five of us, like, oh my gosh, Annie, welcome home. She took one look at us. She was holding the social worker's hand. She broke free and she ran. And so Garrison, our son, was 10 at the time. He looks at us and he goes, well, will they bring up another one? We're like, no.
We've got a runner
down the hallway. That's ours. We got to go get her. So
that sets a precedent right there. She's going to be a runner.
Yes. Yes. So she is, it's been an amazing thing. And what I love is getting to experience adoption from both sides.
Yeah.
We were just talking about, you and I talking about just our mom.
Yeah.
And solid place of safety and secure attachment she provided for us.
Yep.
And I don't know if you know this. I'm just telling you all kinds of stuff today.
Yeah. Keep dropping bombs for me, Erin.
Yeah. Before she died, I was in the hospital with her, and I just laid next to her and sobbed and said, I am so sorry for being such a booty. But when I was a teenager, and I told her, I said, I couldn't love someone more, whether I came from your uterus or I came from your heart.
Yep.
You're my mom, whole and whole. No one can ever take your place.
Yep.
And of course, I'm apologizing. I was so mean to you as a teenager. Oh, Erin, you were a teenager. It's fine. I forgive you.
Yeah.
And bottom line, I know that what the gift she gave me has allowed me to attach not only to my biological kids, but to know that I know that Annie is mine, heart and soul. And there's no difference between blood and not blood. And I always say that about you too, Steve, that you're my brother.
Yep.
Like, I don't care if we are blood related or not. We're more alike than we're not.
Sure.
We went through all the normal sibling stuff, and you know, you're my brother.
Yep.
I love you. I couldn't love another brother more.
Exactly. Well, and that you bring something to mind for me there, because I didn't, I mean, yes, I was adopted, but I didn't adopt a child the way that you did. So I'm curious just to tap on your mama's heart for just a moment. You're talking mm-hmm. about that moment that you're standing there waiting to meet Annie.
Yeah.
I can just picture that your heart was pumping and that your stomach was in knots. But at the same time, did you already know in that moment that you were meeting your daughter? It wasn't like, we'll see if this works. Did you already know you're meeting your child?
It's interesting. And I needed to know that, because I didn't, transpire. God did.
Yeah.
I knew that she was mine. Multiple little details that he aligned. Because she was so attached to her nanny Rose, it was very hard for her to attach to me initially. And we had been with the adoption process, the preparation we had been through, they really stressed that more than likely the child will go to the mother because they're used to women.
Yeah.
They don't have men around, but that was the total opposite for us. She rejected me for a good 2 to 3 months.
Oh, wow. I remember you telling me a little bit about that, but I don't remember being that long.
Specifically, I was not allowed to touch her. She would not let me pick her up. She would throw a temper tantrum and wait for me and headbutt me, kick me, spit at me, bite me. And it was brutal.
I can only imagine.
And I remember, because I'm a therapist, I know that, we were bringing her home. And the resolve, it's funny that you brought that up. Like, did I know she's my daughter? The resolve I had that she was my daughter was so deep that there was no question.
Yeah.
I remember standing on as we were boarding the plane in China, standing on the cement ground, going up the stairs to the plane. Greg had Annie because she wouldn't let me hold her. Mm-hmm. Looking up at the sky and going, God, I don't know what's going to transpire here, but you do. For the rest of my life, it might be that I'm beaten.
Mm.
And that for whatever reason, you brought me to China to bring me to the end of me.
Yeah.
And to trust that you know what's going on here. And to know that this is, I know that this is the right thing.
Mm.
But it was the hardest thing I've ever done.
Wow.
And I got on the plane and I said, I just constantly said, you are my daughter and I'm not taking no for an answer. And thus, when we got home, it meant we had to, we call it cocooning, to where you don't let anybody else in your house.
Mm.
And I have never worked so hard at something that was not tangible. My goal was anything that a mother does is what I did with Annie. So if she wanted to eat, I was the mom, I cooked. I fed her. I changed her. I bathed her. It was me, 100%. And it went on for, a good month after we got home. And it was a constant prayer. Someone told me, anytime she hurts you, you say, I forgive you in Jesus' name. And so I would speak it out loud. They said, she won't understand it, but it's not for her. It's for your heart to stay open.
Wow.
And so every time she headbutt me and I thought she broke my nose, I would say, I forgive you in Jesus' name. I'm going to go cry now, but I'll be back. And it went on until one day we went swimming every day because they say the skin to skin connection in holding her in the water is attaching. And so every day I would hold her and she would headbutt me and I'd put her on the side of the pool and she would run. And one day I was in the water and the girls, my big girls, who were 16 and 13 at the time, standing in the water next to me. And every day I would say, jump to mama. And I'd try, you know, God would lift my hands up because I was weak and weary at that point. And she would jump to the girls and not me. She would shake her head no. And then one day I put my hands up and I said, jump to mama. And the girls were like, mom, just leave her alone. Let her jump to us. And she looked at them and she didn't speak English at that point. She was just learning. And she looked at them and pointed her finger and she said, no. And she looked at me and she said, mama.
Oh,
and she
wow.
jumped from the edge of the pool into my arms by choice. And I caught her. And I called Greg. He had gone back to work. And I was like, I don't know what just happened, but I'm in.
That was the turning point.
That was it. From that day forward, we have been two peas in a pod.
She's I was going to say, you're pretty inseparable now.
Yeah, she's my only extrovert. She's more like me than my biological children. I'll say that. Very extroverted, very relational. My others, I'm surrounded by introverts.
That's so funny.
Yeah, she's just a delight. But it was being persistent and fighting for that connection. And you know, how many relationships do we need to do that with?
Right.
In a marriage, and you know, with God, just continuing to take the stand of I'm not taking no for an answer.
Right.
And I'm going to keep going back. Even though there's hurt, there's pain, I'm going to go take care of my heart, get it back open, forgive you in Jesus' name. And I'm going to come back and go, let's try this again, because I'm not taking no for an answer.
Right. Well, then I'm curious with the rest of the crew, what were those weeks and months like as Annie was kind of being grafted in? And it's not just like, okay, and I got adopted and everything was awesome after that.
Yeah, no, it's interesting because I would say Taylor, probably our oldest, did the best because she was 16. Granted, we ended up moving 10, 11 months later to Colorado, and we had to leave Taylor in Arkansas to graduate from high school. So she was there for 6 months with some friends of ours, and that created some she says it's fine, but I was like, I've never recommend that for anybody, because it was hard to leave a child. Murphy was 13 at the time and she had the hardest time, and she can look back on that and she says that is when she felt replaced. And it's each of them have processed it differently. Murphy wouldn't mind me saying she's gone to therapy to work through it, and just to reformat, to reestablish our connection, our attachment.
Yeah.
Garrison, he was baby boy. So two girls and youngest was a boy.
Right.
Garrison. And he was 10. And Annie rocked his world. And initially, at one point, he even asked if we could send her back.
Oh, my.
And my sweet husband got on American Airlines and looked at, you know, he was like, well, which seat would we put her in? And he said the whole time, he's going, dear God, please let him change his mind. Because how am I going to play this out? But
awesome.
Garrison really, really struggled. And what's really cool is he's 20, almost 21, and Annie's 14. And I would say that I continue to watch God just do a miracle. And Annie adores him, and he adores her, but they're siblings.
Yep.
And she's all 4'8" and he's, you know, 5'11" and a half, and she can push his buttons like nobody else. So they are brother and sister, and it's been a journey, to say the least, but one that's been well worth it.
Right. But okay. You're talking of a total of how many years now?
11, it'll be 12, July 4th this year.
Okay. Would you trade a single day of those 12 years?
Absolutely not.
Even the days when it seemed like, oh my gosh, are we ever going to get through whatever phase?
Yeah. You know, it's interesting. When we first got home, I had one friend who I would go walking with, and she looked at me and she said, how do you feel about being Annie's mom right now? And this was like 2 weeks in.
Oh, wow.
And I literally, I was like, oh my gosh, I cannot believe you're asking me that question right now. But it allowed me to go, you know what? I don't know yet.
Mm.
I'm working on it.
That was honest.
Very honest. And it was interesting when we got home, because she only spoke Mandarin.
Yeah.
There was a missionary that happened to be home, and she lived up the street from us in Arkansas, of all places. And she spoke Mandarin.
Oh,
and
wow.
So she asked Annie in Mandarin how she felt about us. And the missionary came back and she goes, Erin, I hate to tell you this, she doesn't like you. And I was like, well, duh, I already know that.
Here comes the report card. Oh, that is so funny.
I'm not surprised. So, it just was a matter of taking, I've never had anything in my life that I had to take a firmer stand on.
Yeah.
That you're my daughter and that means I love you. And I'm going to fight for that connection and whatever it means, whatever I have to do. And you know what? But what I will always go back to, we have to do the same thing with our biological kids.
Yep.
They go through stuff and they all go through different things. And, you know, as they go through their stuff, it's taking a stand to go, you know what? I love you and we're going to get through this. And I, especially our second daughter, I would always say, you're going to be a great adult. And that's what with Annie, it was, I love you. You're my daughter. And we're going to get through this to the other side. And we did.
Right. Well, and you throw into the mix that, I mean, obviously, just the quick givens that you are bringing this child over from China and trying to meld her into an American family and all of the friction that seems built in. Then you throw in that there were some physical issues that you guys had to deal with her and medically and things like that, that had to throw in that many more wrenches, that nothing about this was going to be easy. How did you guys contend with all of that? And because all of that still isn't really even done completely, is it?
No. Yeah, we did. We knew she needed medical care. And that was, I would lay awake at night when we were awaiting going to pick her up, just going, God, how am I going to do this? Like, there's one of me, I have three other kids. And we're bringing in a child. We live in a small town in the middle of Arkansas, to where any medical care is at least an hour away. You know, big hospitals are 4.5 hours away. They were telling us she was going to need like physical therapy and, you know, 3 times a week. And I mean, I was completely overwhelmed, but I just kept going, I don't get it. I'm taking the next step forward. And the crazy thing, that first 6 months that she was home, I think I counted at one point, I made 23 visits to the same orthopedic doctor. All 23 of them were for my biological children. All three of them had orthopedic issues they had never had before. And Annie was the one that needed medical attention. And really it ended up being that she ended up having one surgery. She has something called amniotic band syndrome, which is, there's a rip in the amniotic sac in utero and it causes malformation of limbs and also cleft lip and palate. So she had cleft lip and palate and she has a special left hand and she had a club foot. The club foot was fully corrected. Her cleft lip and palate had been mainly taken care of, but she needed tubes in her ears. She had severe ear infections. And we did a hand surgery within the first 9 months of her coming home. And the thing that the benefit of that is that kids, when they have the special needs and they have to have medical attention or surgery, they say that it's super attaching because they learn that when they go into surgery, you're there. And when they come out of surgery, you're still there.
Right.
And I will say that as hard as that was, having to, you know, let her go into the OR. And by the way, we've done that. She's had 14 surgeries.
Wow.
And so just the brutal, it's a brutal separation.
Sure.
For her, for us. But it also breeds a deep, deep connection. And so she's just a little rock star, because you would never know she has been through all that.
Right. Well, and how bonding each of those moments must have been, I mean, exponentially every time for all of you.
Yes. And the prayer, because I remember, you know, at first she wasn't verbalizing her, you could see her fear.
Yeah.
Like she'd be crying and she'd be screaming as they took her away. and then here in Colorado, they're really good at the Children's Hospital about letting you walk in with them and lay them down on the table and stay with them until they go to sleep. But at one point she was probably about 6 or 7. And just talking about, I'm so nervous. I'm so scared. I don't know how I'm going to do this. And I was like, God, I don't know what to do here. And then I was like, oh, I could teach her scripture. Like, duh. Hey. And so I taught her Joshua 1:9. She memorized it. Be strong and courageous.
Have I not commanded you? Yep.
Yes. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you may go. And I would say, Annie, God is with you. I can't go with you into the surgery. I can walk you in, but I have to walk out.
Right.
God doesn't walk out. He stays there with you.
Mm.
And this one surgery in particular, when we taught her that, we're pushing the car, you know, the bed down the hallway to the OR. And I saw her little lips just moving. And I leaned in and she was reciting Joshua 1:9.
Nice.
Do not be terrified. Do not be dismayed. Be strong and courageous. And so, I mean, only with God through this whole process has it been, you know, that God has given us the strength and the courage to do the next thing. And we have another surgery coming up probably this summer. She's getting to the end of her cleft lip and palate repair.
Mm.
And so we're down to two surgeries is what they're telling us. And so the summer we'll do one more. And then pretty soon after that, she'll have her last. And what a rejoicing party we're going to have, because it has been, it's been a lot. But I will tell you, God has used it in her life. The child is more empathic, compassionate. She hears someone's having surgery. She wants to take them meals and cards and balloons. And, you know, she's praying for them. I mean, but she gets it at a level that other kids who don't go through that don't get.
Right. Well, and with that, has it may be still a lot for her to contend with at the ripe old age of 14, but do you see things occurring to her that she has been called to a purpose, for a purpose, that her life is bigger than her 4-foot frame, 4-foot eight frame will ever look like in stature, but that she is called by God to something amazing that might not have happened had her life stayed on its earliest trajectory.
Yeah. I always look at that God uses our weaknesses. And so, you know, or where we're not flawed, but what's difficult for us. Mm. You think about, you know, her speech is a challenge for her.
Mm-hmm.
And I just constantly think, you know what? She is in a family of public speakers.
Yeah.
And she travels with us to our marriage events and sits, she sat through more marriage conferences and her mom and dad speaking than I can promise you any 14-year-old.
Yep.
So recently she was at, for eighth grade, their school goes on an overnight thing. And they asked anybody if they'd like to share about adoption.
Mm.
And a mom videoed it for me and sent it to me.
Oh,
and there
nice.
Was my little Annie with a microphone in her hand. And by the way, she had this huge, thick metal expander in the roof of her mouth. So it was really hard for her to talk.
Oh.
And she's up there telling her story about how her mom and dad prayed and prayed and found her in China. And we went and got her and adopted her and brought her home. And
she knows,
you know, so she gets it. But I think, you know, she's 14. So she's going through all the typical junior high difficulties of who am I? I'm awkward and yep. where do I fit in and all that kind of stuff. But what I know to be true, you know, kind of looping back to where we started, my job is to provide her that safe place mm-hmm. for her to express those things. But then my opportunity, as she cries with me, as she, you know, tells me what a hard day it was that someone made fun of her or teased her because of her differences or just for being a girl and being 14.
Yeah.
That, you know, I can hold her. I can tell her how much I love her and how God loves her and how, what I see in her and that I will never stop accepting her and loving her. And, you know, that is, that brings healing to those wounds.
Yeah.
From the beginning of her story of being left on the stairs of a underwear factory in China.
Right.
By herself.
What do you see for Annie's future? And I realize you've still got some, mm-hmm. you've got all the rest of the teen years to navigate.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That regardless of how many yeah. times you go through those, you know that each one uh-huh. is so unique. and it's funny because I realize I haven't seen her for a couple of years now. And what, she just cracked me up when I was there visiting you guys a couple summers ago because she is such yeah. a little spitfire that I'm,
she is. Well,
I can't wait
say-
to see Annie as a driver.
Oh my, and that's coming. She's going to be 15. She'll get a permit this July. I'm like, how is she going to see over the steering wheel? But so, I mean, she is spirited beyond words. Last yes. night was the father-daughter dinner dance. And I was dying laughing. I got to go because our dear friends have done this dinner dance for 25 years and they're kind of stepping away. And just so I got to go as a mom just to honor my friend, but they were there as daddy daughter and they have dinner and then they have dancing and the child has more groove than I mean, she has her uncle Steve or Uncle B as they call you. I see. It's so unique to see is each of our kids mature and you see their giftedness and how God has gifted them.
Mm-hmm.
She will often say, I don't know. It's so overwhelming, Mom. I don't know what I'm going to do. Which job will I do? Will I be a doctor and help kids? Will I be an engineer or will I be a counselor? And then today she said, well, maybe I'll be a dancer.
There's a range.
I was dying laughing last night. My husband doesn't love to dance and he's with her who loves to dance and can bust a move. And she, you know, she's in the minute the music starts, she's taking her hair out of her bun and whipping it around and just on the groove. I mean, absolutely hilarious. So maybe she'll be a dancer.
Oh, that's so hilarious. Okay. Yeah. And it's awesome because you're right. And it goes even with what I was just saying, all the teenage years where it seems like, well, yeah, you can think of six different things you want to be when you grow up. That it's not the let's play the where do you see yourself in 10 years? Where do yeah. you see her based on what you know that you've instilled in her, what you and Greg have built in her to be?
She'll be a powerhouse.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I know like I did for that day standing on the tarmac going, okay, here we go, God. Don't know what you have, but you've given me her and she doesn't like me. But I'm believing she's my daughter. And it's the same thing. It's the resolve that God brought her to us for a reason, for a purpose. He created her on purpose. For it with a purpose. Mm-hmm. And can't wait to see what that is. But I know she loves Jesus with all of her heart.
Yeah.
She loves people with all of her heart. She's bossy. She's sassy. She is everything a 14-year-old can be. And as tender, as sweet as can be as well. Yeah, we'll see what she does. I know God has things for her. There's a reason. I've always said I could see her marching around China testifying to God's goodness. And I know her story is one that when people hear it, it brings them to tears.
Sure.
Just about how God orchestrated her coming by so many. I know that God cares about the details.
Yeah, he does.
And I know that he brought her, as he does for each of us, that he brought you and I together as brother and sister. He brought us to our mom and dad. Mm-hmm. And there's times I go, huh, interesting.
Yeah.
But I know that he chose.
Right.
And
people that you would just never think would ever work together living under the same roof.
Yeah.
And yet somehow yes. We managed to survive it.
Yeah. He makes us family at a deep level.
Exactly.
And, you know, were our parents perfect? No. And, you know, they made their share of, you know, their fair share of mistakes as we did as parents. But mm-hmm. I know that God put us in the right family, and yep. He put Annie in the right family as well.
Right. Without taking things down a completely brutal road, I'm just curious, and this is probably maybe even more for me, but what would you give for mom to have met Annie Rose?
Mm-hmm. Oh, just about anything.
Yeah.
We talk about her all the time. Annie knows she's named after her,
yeah.
And she'll even tell me sometimes I miss her.
Well, that.
And I'm like, you didn't meet her, but I, in my own little theology, I like to imagine that somehow they were in heaven together between April and July when she was born. In some ways, I think, you know, maybe mom hand selected her. And she said, Erin, because you were so mean to me as a teenager, I'm going to send you a feisty one. Now, I know that theologically is not accurate, but I just like to think, you know, maybe somehow, some way they met.
Yeah.
And I know that in scripture, it says the saints in heaven have glimpses of earth.
Yep.
And I like to believe that she sees her and she knows that we carried that out as we said we were going to.
Right.
I know someday Annie will meet her in heaven
mm-hmm.
and it'll be a glorious reunion.
Listening to this conversation, can you hear your own story in there? God went to the most extreme lengths to get to you. He gave the life of his own son to get to you. He took you into his family with all of your hurts and hang-ups because it brought him great pleasure. And if I may take just a moment to speak to the one who is listening and is still just checking out the claims of Jesus. And maybe you've never considered what it might mean for you to be adopted by God, to be melded into his family. No matter what you have done, no matter what you are thinking might disqualify you from the Father's love, he is waiting. He knows everything about you, and none of it will keep him from loving you. And please hear the words from this rescued orphan. God cannot love you any more than he does right now in this moment. His love is perfect, and he would love nothing more than to adopt you into his family. I have got some more amazing stories of adoption coming this month, each one so unique. Make sure that you are subscribed or following on your favorite podcast app. A 5-star rating and a good review on Apple Podcasts really does help, and thank you to those of you who have taken the time to do just that. Check for the links in the description to the Nook Facebook page and for my social media feeds. I'd love to have you following along. Thank you so much for listening today, and I will catch you here next time in the Nook. The Nook Podcast is a production of Sozo Digital Media.